welcome to this AbundantChange.com program, brought to you by Music Outreach Publishing. We here at Music Outreach hope you will enjoy and be uplifted by this offering, and wish you many blessings. And now, without further ado, here is author and founder of Music Outreach Publishing, Michael Purvis. Hello, everyone. I'm Michael Purvis, the author of this program and founder of AbundantChange.com and Music Outreach Publishing. The AbundantChange.com recording you're about to experience is my attempt to delight, uplift, and instruct people of all ages through music and the spoken and written word throughout the United States and all over the world. As an author, inspirational performer, artist, and teacher, I have made it my goal to create inspiring books, recordings, and videos which will touch the lives of and benefit children, youths, young adults, adults, couples, and senior citizens. So, through the magic of technology, here I am, ready to uplift you with words and music on all sorts of beneficial, uplifting, spiritual, and growth-inducing topics. If you or someone you know would like more information about AbundantChange.com materials available worldwide from Music Outreach Publishing, stay with us at the end of this recording, and we'll give you information about how to contact us. And now, without further ado, on with our program. Welcome to our program, which is entitled Charlie the Fieldmouse and the Song of the Corn. This is a delightful, poetic story for children, young and old, big and small, which encourages love for the arts and concern for the environment. I hope you'll enjoy it. So let's get started. First, we'll begin with our special Abundant Change theme song to get us in the mood to learn, grow, and be uplifted by this program. Speak to all ages, God's gift to me and you. You can put them down to music, or read and write them too. Abundant change, that's how we humans increase our range of spirit, love, and life in you. May this book be my special gift to you. Young, tall or short, we all have tales to tell. We've dreams to dream and things to learn, so we can grow so well. Abundant change, that's how we humans increase our range of spirit, love, and life anew. May this book be my special gift to to you. Growing, changing, that's the life we lead. In our hearts and minds and spirits, we have all we need. So now as we begin our tale, may I be so bold as to hope that it will lift you up, help your new worlds to unfold. Abundant change, that's how we humans increase our range of spirit, love, and life anew. May this book be my special gift to you. Introduction. This book for children, big and small, young and old, I hope has a lot to teach us all about love for the arts and their importance in our lives. As well, a concern for the environment is stressed in this story, as there shall be no more beautiful earth for artists to create upon if we continue to cover it up with strip malls, if we gobble up our precious farm and forest lands, and if we pollute our environment. I believe the little field mice in our story have a lot to teach us, for we are not so different from them. We all, human and animal alike, depend upon our Mother Earth for sustenance, and we would miss, more than we know, our beautiful way of life here on our planet, which we often take for granted, should it suddenly change or cease to exist as we know it. We can learn a lot from little mice. And now, please enjoy Charlie the Field Mouse and the Song of the Corn. The author. Dedication. To my mother Marlene, who taught me to read at an early age and nurtured in me the love of books and words. Charlie the Field Mouse and the Song of the Corn. Every year, as the wheel of the seasons turned, Charlie the Field Mouse and his clan of field mice especially loved autumn. It wasn't just that the farmer would leave behind all sorts of bits for the mice to gather when he harvested his field, though this was wonderful and essential for the mice. It was more than this. It was the anticipation of what came after each day of gathering for the field mice. And what was this wondrous thing that the mice anticipated after each day's work of gathering the scraps and tidbits left by the farmer in his field? Every autumn evening, after a full day of gathering for the winter, Charlie and his brother and sister mice would sit at the edge of the field and listen to a concert. And who gave this concert that the mice so loved to listen to at the end of their day of gathering? It was the corn. The concert consisted of the beautiful rustling of the fall cornstalks, the lovely singing of the corn, which from time immemorial the field mice have called the corn concert. And after this daily concert, it was home to their burrows for the adult mice for supper and tea, and the all-important job of tucking the littlest field mice into bed. These little mice were too small to gather the scraps and tidbits in the farmer's field, and too small to go to the delightful corn concerts, but they loved to hear about the gathering, and especially the concerts. They dreamed that someday they too would be big and strong and take part in all the mysterious and exciting things the adult mice did. But for the time being, they had to settle for hearing about the gathering and the corn concerts each night before being tucked into bed. It was a sort of ritual, like a bedtime story, this recounting of the day's gathering, and of course the wondrous corn concert. All of the adult mice told of these things to their little ones, but none were as adept and as good at this duty as Charlie, the field mouse. He was known as Uncle Charlie to the little mice in the household of Beatrice Fieldmouse, for he was her brother. And throughout the Fieldmouse clan, he was known as Charlie the Fieldmouse, storyteller and singer extraordinaire, for he was much beloved by one and all for his abilities in these areas, but especially by the littlest of the mice. Each night before bed in the living room of Aunt Beatrice's burrow, the little mice would say almost in unison to Uncle Charlie, "A concert? By the corn? On our farm?" And this was Uncle Charlie's cue to begin the story of the day's work and his rendition of the corn concert. "Yes, a concert. On our farm," Charlie would say to the little mice, "and when you are bigger, we will sit by the edge of the field together and listen to the corn singing." "Corn can sing?" the little mice would ask. "Oh, yes," Uncle Charlie would reply, with a wistful look in his little black eyes. "Corn sings the most beautiful song in autumn as the wind rustles through its leaves." "Sing it for us, sing it for us. Oh, please, please, Uncle Charlie," the little mice would chant. And Charlie dutifully would close his eyes, remembering all the autumn corn concerts he had known, and sing the song the corn sings each autumn evening at dusk, as the wind picks up and the twilight air begins to grow colder. Charlie would sing the corn's beautiful song to the little mice each time they asked, which was, of course, every autumn evening, in his richest field mouse tenor voice. This is what he sang. When down the sun goes in richest colored hues, and all the field mice gather to rest from their gathering. When the wind starts to blow and a chill besets our fur, we've one more thing to witness, one more thing to occur. Oh, it's the song of the corn. Oh, how the wind rustles. The leaves of the corn start to tussle and to bustle. Ooh, and whoosh, and wee, it sings the song of the corn. And all good field mice call a truce to their labors. Yes, all field mice gather to rest from their gathering. And sun starts to set in a blaze of lush color. And the moon, it starts to rise, and we cease our work and dolor. Oh, it's the song of the corn. Oh, how the wind rustles. The leaves of the corn start to tussle and to bustle. Ooh, and whoosh, and wee, it sings the song of the corn. It's the song of the corn. Oh, how the wind rustles. the leaves of the corn start to tussle and to bustle. Ooh, and whoosh, and wee, it sings the song of the corn, of the corn. Ooh, and whoosh, and wee, it sings, yes, the song of the corn. And each time Uncle Charlie would sing the song of the corn in his beautiful Irish tenor field mouse voice, the little field mice, who were too small to go to hear the corn concerts, would close their eyes, and a peaceful look would be upon their faces as they listened to it. And when Uncle Charlie was finished, they would open their eyes, wide with wonder, having imagined what it would be like to hear the concert of the corn. After listening, they would say, "Oh, Uncle Charlie, we love that beautiful song you sing. When can we go to the corn concert? When can we go?" And Uncle Charlie would reply, "When you are grown, little mice, when you are big, then you will gather the corn kernels that the farmer leaves, the stray ears, and all the scraps from the field. And then at the end of a day of gathering, you will assemble with the rest of the grown mice to hear the song of the corn. You will become a part of this assembling of the mice, which has been called the concert of the corn by all field mice since time began." And then Aunt Beatrice would always come in and say, "That's enough now, children. You've heard enough about the world of grown-up field mice from your Uncle Charlie. Enjoy being a little mouse while you can, for when you are grown, there is ever so much to do. That's enough now. Off to bed. Time to let Uncle Charlie rest his bones. You know it's not easy being a grown-up mouse and gathering the scraps of the field with the other grown-up mice. There is little time to play, little mice, when you are grown. Off to bed. Off to bed, all of you." And when the little mice were snug in their beds, Aunt Beatrice and Uncle Charlie would sit by the fire and rock in their rocking chairs. Aunt Beatrice would knit with tiny little knitting needles, little socks, little blankets made of a special yarn which came from the silken tufts of the corn, a special yarn which Aunt Beatrice made into so many useful items. And while Aunt Beatrice knitted, Uncle Charlie would sit by the fire with her and smoke a special little pipe made from a dried kernel of corn and a hollowed-out leaf stem. This little scene was replayed many a night, and all was well in the burrows of the field mice. All was well until one day there were rumors among the grown-up mice, rumors that soon things might be changing on the farm. The farmer, you see, was not having a good season. In fact, for several seasons, the farm had not done well financially. "And just maybe," said the rumors, "the fields would soon be sold to local builders to erect houses, stores, and offices upon. And no more would there be the golden corn. No more would exist the life the field mice had known." These rumors struck great fear in the hearts of the field mice. The grown-ups tried to keep their fear from showing in their faces and voices. They tried to keep this rumor from reaching the ears of the little field mice. But soon, even the little ones knew of the impending danger. All the mice, young and old, feared that no more would the golden corn sing. No more would the grown field mice gather to hear the concert of the corn after each day of gathering in the fields. No more would Uncle Charlie tell stories and sing the song of the corn to the little ones at night, and Aunt Beatrice shoo them off to bed. Was this time-honored way of life coming to an end? Perhaps, all too soon, Uncle Charlie, Aunt Beatrice, and the other grown-up mice worried. How did they know about this change, which might be coming? Well, they knew because Rat-a-tat-tat, the barn rat, had paid them a visit. Now, the field mice had not always been friends with the barn rats, but in times of trouble, the mice and the barn rats hung together. Rat-a-tat-tat said he had overheard the cow and the pig and the duck having a little conference. Like the field mice and the barn rats, the cow and the pig and the duck had not always gotten along so well in the past either. They often squawked at each other and argued. But on the day that Rat-a-tat-tat overheard their discussion, they were calm and respectful and were speaking in concerned, hushed tones. They were discussing earnestly and solemnly the fact that they had overheard the farmer talking with his wife when she was milking cow. They had overheard the children of the farmer, too, speaking during their chores in the barn and during their play in the barnyard. And just what had the cow, the pig, and the duck overheard the human speaking of, which made them cease their petty rivalries and speak together in such an attentive and serious manner? Well, it seemed that a change was coming for all concerned, both human and animal. It seemed that the farm might well be sold, and this change had the entire farm all abuzz. From the field mice and the barn rats, to the livestock and poultry, to the farmer and his family, the impending possible change for the farm seemed to be all that anyone could think of or speak of. And this was not surprising, for it would mean the end of this life which they had grown to know so well and to love. It was, after all, the only life they had ever known. What would the future hold, they all wondered, if the farm were sold? They could not know. They could only imagine. The humans tried to make a decision, and the animals waited to hear the humans' decision. And so the days went by. Each day brought more worry for the field mice. Even the beautiful song of the corn did not soothe their troubled hearts. More rumors came from the farms nearby. Some of the farms were being sold, and there could be seen little bands of mice with little kerchiefs tied to sticks slung over their backs, traveling through the countryside looking for new homes. As they traveled and marched, they chanted and sang a mournful little dirge. This is how it went. Tramp, little mice, tramping to a new locale. Where, oh, where shall we go? We know not where, but go we shall. Tramp, tramp, little mice, leaving the life we've known. Oh, to leave it makes us sad. The only life we've ever had. And they would continue chanting, so many memories we must leave behind. Oh, fates, be with us, and please be kind. Oh, what is to become of us? Aunt Beatrice would wail in the evenings. Uncle Charlie would say to her, there, there now, Bee, all shall be well, you will see. And then he would sing her a comforting little song, which always made her feel better. And this is how it went. There, there, now, Bee. All shall be well, can't you see? just when things are looking down. That's no time for us to frown. There, there, dear one of mine, all shall be fine in time. God shall preserve all we own and all the love that we have known. The corn shall sing every night at dusk for the field mice at the end of the day, and all the furry, bright-eyed little ones will be waiting for us after school and play. There, there, now be. There, there, now be. All shall be well, can't you see? Just when things are looking down, that's no time for us to frown. There, there, dear one of mine, all shall be fine in time. God shall preserve all we own and all the love that we have known. Just when you feel all is lost, that's the time to be brave and not count the cost. Though things seem dark and oh so very bleak, God is watching over us this night. And though we fear that all we love is lost, we'll take heart, for God loves the tempest tossed. There, there, now be. All shall be well, can't you see? Just when things are looking down, that's no time for us to frown. There, there, dear one of mine, all shall be fine in time. God shall preserve all we own and all the love that we have known. The love we have known. Well, things went on like this for quite a while, the tension building. All were increasingly afraid of what might soon be their fate. Then one day a meeting of all the adult mice was called, a meeting of the entire field mice clan. It was a chill autumn day when the call for a meeting was sounded. From mouse to mouse the news traveled, from burrow to burrow, and throughout the fields the news quickly spread. All ceased their labors and traveled to the field mouse meeting house, a large cavernous room which they all entered through a hole in the farm's big stone fence. This hole was located just where the fence met one of the big stone towers which held up the gate at the entrance of the farm. Now, this stone tower, as did its twin set on the other side of the drive, had a large brass electric lantern atop it. At night, these lights illuminated a large sign which was set in wrought iron above the gate. The sign was painted in gold letters and said, Applegate Farm. Above the letters was painted a scene which showed a field. This field represented the very fields, in fact, which the mice knew so well. On the sign as well, beside the field, was rendered an apple tree to signify the apple orchard adjacent to the fields of the farm. It was actually quite an elegant sign for a farm to have at its entrance, and had been painted by the farmer's eccentric aunt, an artist who sometimes came to visit. When she visited, she brought with her eccentric artist friends from the city, whom the farmer, being a simple, no-nonsense sort of man, loathed. His wife and children loved these visitors, however, and so the farmer tolerated these citified guests with their loud voices and citified ways. These visits were fascinating for the mice because they overheard all sorts of stories of goings-on in the city, and the city was a place of mystery for them, being country mice. The sign towering over their meeting house had always been a beautiful sight for the field mice, which they enjoyed looking up to see as they came to their monthly field mouse meetings. Yet today, no little pink noses pointed up toward the sky. Today, no little black eyes peered through tiny spectacles at the sign's artistry. This was a special meeting, urgent in nature, and the mice had their minds on other things than the beauty of the grand sign. Today they hurried inside as they arrived, not pausing to look up at the sign, nor pausing even to think of its eccentric creator and her retinue of unusual friends, full of stories of dramas from the city. No, today the mice had a real-life drama to contend with. They hadn't time to think of the many wild tales they had heard the farmer's eccentric aunt and her city friends tell. Life seemed wild and unpredictable enough today, and had seemed so ever since the rumors of the possible sale of the farm began. Nose to the ground, and with a gait of purposefulness, the little mice quickly entered the meeting house. They scurried inside through the hole in the fence, right at the corner where the gate met the tower. Inside the cavernous hollow room, which the inside of the tower formed, they all moved quickly to their seats, comprised of hollowed walnut shells. They sat, chattering worriedly to each other, waiting for the meeting to come to order. Old Rumpleberry, the leader of the Field Mouse Clan, called the meeting to order with a bang of his gavel. Hear, hear. The meeting of the Field Mice, is now called to order, shouted Old Rumpleberry, a bit grouchy of countenance. Some of the mice continued their chatter. The meeting is called to order, declared Rumpleberry, a bit louder and more insistent this time, banging his gavel. His gavel went again upon the tree branch podium. The room quieted, and Old Rumpleberry peered grimly down his snout, looking gravely through the spectacles resting just above his nose, as though daring any discourteous mouse to make another noise. "The floor recognizes," he said, in a gravelly, rather ancient-sounding voice, "Charlie the Field Mouse." Charlie stood up a bit nervously. He swallowed and felt a lump in his throat. He was at home singing the song of the corn and telling stories to the little field mice in the evenings, but speaking to the entire field mouse clan, well, that was a little intimidating. Old Rumpleberry's demeanor didn't help either, but nonetheless Charlie proceeded to testify, to tell what he had come to report. Though what he was saying was not news to the other mice, he had been chosen to make a formal report of the situation at hand to the meeting of the mice, to begin the proceedings. On and on the meeting went, with many a mouse relating what they had witnessed and what they feared. Much fear was related, and not much in the way of solutions were offered. The general worry was the suspicion that the members of the Field Mouse Clan of Applegate Farm might be on the march soon, like the bands of homeless mice they had seen traveling through the countryside so much of late. The meeting went on as such, and then a very strange and surprising thing occurred. A long, dark shadow fell across the entire floor of the mouse meeting house. All turned nervously to see who or what might be darkening the door to the room and casting such a pall of darkness. And who or what was causing this large, ominous pall to fall across the room? The mice all turned to see in the doorway the faces of three whom they feared, and an audible gasp was heard in the now silent meeting hall. Each mouse, their hearts racing, now recognized the faces of Rat-a-tat-tat the barn rat, Hootrilla the owl, who lived in the rafters of the barn, and Clarence the fat, spoiled house cat. Thank you. just as all the mice were about to scramble in all directions, each hoping to save themselves if possible, Rat-a-tat-tat the barn rat hastily uttered, "Wait! Don't run! We come in peace!" Could this be? The rats had not been the field mice's friends, nor had Hootrilla the barn owl, and certainly not Clarence the fat, spoiled house cat, who, when he was allowed out on his nightly romps, would terrorize the field mice. Despite this, everyone stood quite still to listen to Rat-a-tat-tat the barn rat. "I know normally we are not the best of friends," he began sheepishly, "but under the circumstances we must all learn to work together, and Clarence the cat has an idea I think you might all want to hear. May we come in?" Well, the mice were very frightened, but old Rumpleberry cleared his throat and in a loud, clear voice said, "Very well, then, come inside and let us be friends together, since we face great danger." And so Rat-a-tat-tat the barn rat, Hootrilla the barn owl, and Clarence the fat, spoiled house cat, one by one squeezed through the opening in the corner of the fence, which served as the door to the meeting house. Presently, they were all three inside the tall mouse meeting house interior, with all the little field mice.
"Well," said Rumpleberry, a bit nervously, "let us hear your proposal. The floor recognizes Clarence, the house cat."
"Well," said Clarence in his usual sly voice, "I happen to know from overhearing the conversations of the farmer and his wife that a certain Smith and Sons has offered to buy our farm. Smith and Sons plans to build a large housing addition and a strip of stores for shopping for the humans." There was an audible gasp from the assembly of mice, and Clarence continued, "I have an idea that just might help us in our predicament. We'd all like things to go on as they have been. Even the farmer and his wife would like to keep the farm. Now, for my idea." The big, fat, furry cat cleared his throat and began to tell his idea. "It occurs to me," said Clarence, "that a strategy which I have used successfully for increasing the number of my kitty treats might just work in this situation. Both the farmer and his wife are sound sleepers, and I've become quite fond of my kitty treats, you see. And if I whisper, 'Kitty treats, kitty treats, more kitty treats for Clarence,' into the ears of the farmer and his wife while they're sleeping, it's almost as if magic occurs." The next day, the farmer and his wife seem to increase in kindness. They seem, of their own accord, without any coaxing from me, to offer me more kitty treats. I don't have to rub against their legs, to purr, or look up to them with my hypnotizing cat eyes. They just seem to offer them."
"I have an explanation for this," said Hootrilla. Old Rumpleberry, still somewhat in shock from the ingenuity of Clarence the cat's clever idea, said unhesitatingly, "The floor recognizes Hootrilla the barn owl."
Hootrilla knew a great deal about matters of the forest and matters related to the animal and the human world. The wise old owl began, somewhat pompously and with authority,
"Well, this is a kind of hypnotic suggestion that is induced through a catalyst, a word that has nothing to do with kitty cats, but means, rather, that one special thing causes something else, a reaction, to happen. In this case, it is the whisper in the ear, which goes into the mind of the human, and then it settles in. And at the appropriate time, when kitty treats are near, presents itself. Voila! Elementary, my dear little mice."
Rat-a-tat-tat interrupted.
"Oh, stop showing off, Hootrilla."
"Well, as I was saying," continued Clarence the cat,
"The floor recognizes Clarence the Cat," said old Rumpleberry. "I just thought if it worked on the farmer and his wife in regards to increasing my kitty treats, it might just work on Smith and Sons in regards to saving our farm. Now, Rat-a-tat-tat, upon hearing my idea, thought of some specifics as to how we might use this method on Smith and Sons to save our farm. Tell them, Rat-a-tat-tat."
"The floor recognizes Rat-a-tat-tat the barn rat," said old Rumpleberry.
"Well, we don't know whether Smith and his sons are light sleepers," Rat-a-tat-tat began, "but it may just be that a house cat, and a fat, spoiled house cat at that."
"Hey," interjected Clarence, offended. Rat-a-tat-tat continued, "might just wake up Mr. Smith and his sons. As well, the barn rats might be too heavy. But you field mice are little and light. You could climb into Mr. Smith's bedroom at night and into his sons' rooms and in their own houses, too. Then you could very quietly climb atop each bedstead and dangle from it, helping each other, looping each other's tails. And on the end of that chain, the mouse with the most soothing, calm little voice would whisper, 'Farmer McGregor's farm must stay a farm. Farmer McGregor's farm must stay a farm.' Over and over, the mouse with the most soothing voice must say this in each house where Mr. Smith or one of his sons reside."
Well, at this, all the mice began to chatter. Everyone was abuzz. Perhaps Clarence the Cat and Rat-a-tat-tat the barn rat had something here. Went old Rumpleberry's gavel.
"The meeting will come to order! The meeting will come to order!" he shouted. Reluctantly, the mice quieted down. "All in favor of the plan presented by Clarence the Cat and Rat-a-tat the barn rat signify by standing up on their hind paws."
Well, the entire assembly stood up on their hind paws, even Clarence the Cat, and Hootrilla the Barn Owl, and Rat-a-tat-tat the Barn Rat. And so it was that a plan was hatched. At night, every night for a week, Hootrilla would fly ahead, seeing that all was safe. The rats would paw their way through the fields and along the sides of the roads, each with a little field mouse on their back. Beatrice and the other field mice ladies had knitted little woolen booties for each mouse to wear, so that their little nails might not wake the Smith and Sons sleepers. Every night before they set out, Hootrilla, Rat-a-tat-tat, Clarence, and all the mice would meet in the mouse meeting house. They would stand in a circle and say a little prayer, a prayer of togetherness, a prayer of working together, a prayer of thanks to God for watching over them and helping them to see how they could work together. Then they would sing a little song which Esmeralda, the composer of the mice community, had written to help them have solidarity and give them courage for their nightly trip to the Smith and Sons' homes. This is how the song went. Thank you, dear God, for all your love and care. Thank you, dear God, we are not in despair. For you have shown us how we can work together. You have shown us how our hearts can be light as a feather. We no longer worry. We know that all shall be well. For if we work together, our children will tell of how once long ago danger was skirted by a clever plan, a clever plan. A sad fate was averted. Thank you, dear God. We are not in despair, for you have shown us how we can work together. You've shown us how our hearts can be light as a feather. We no longer wring our paws, nor toss and turn at night. Worrying isn't necessary due to what our clever Clarence saw. He hatched a clever plan, which we have executed. By working as a band, a team, all danger has been transmuted. Thank you, dear God, for all your love and care. Thank you, dear God, we are not in despair, for you have shown us how we can work together. You've shown us how our hearts can be light, light as a feather. Thank you, dear God. 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 Thank you. Every night for a week, they all worked together and made the trek to the quiet Smith and Sons bedrooms. Every night, the mouse with the most soothing voice, which was, of course, none other than Charlie the field mouse, would whisper, "Farmer McGregor's farm must stay a farm." Well, on Sunday, when the mice gathered to have church in their little meeting house, they prayed for success, just as old Pastor Pumpernickel, whom they called Reverend Mouse, began to ascend the lectern to give the sermon. Once again, the hall was darkened by the shadow of three figures. The little mice turned in their mice pews, made of corn cobs, to see the faces of their three former enemies, now the compatriots in saving the farm. Rat-a-tat-tat the barn rat, Hootrilla the barn owl, and Clarence the house cat.
"Please excuse our interruption," said Rat-a-tat-tat, "but we have news."
Pastor Pumpernickel said ingratiously, come in, please tell us your news. My sermon can wait." Excited whispers ran throughout the congregation of mice as Hootrilla and Clarence sat down at the back of the meeting house, for they were too large to move through the corncob pews without disturbing the mice. Rat-a-tat-tat, who was smaller than his two companions, made his way up the aisle to the front of the little mouse meeting house, now set up for church.
"Well, it appears our plan has been successful," he began. "Clarence, will you tell what you have heard from the farmer and his wife?"
Clarence cleared his throat, smiled, and with a clear voice, which was not sly, but this time much more congenial, told his news.
"Well, as I laid curled, as usual, in a ball at the feet of the farmer's wife, this morning during breakfast, the phone rang. The farmer grumbled, 'Who could that be on a Sunday morning of all times?' Then he picked up the phone, said, 'quite a lot,' and then said, 'Thank you,' and hung up. Next, I heard the farmer and his wife discussing the call. What they said was truly amazing."
"Please do tell us all," said Pastor Pumpernickel. "We are on pins and needles."
Clarence continued.
"Well, the long and short of it is that after cracking his poached egg, the farmer, much to my surprise, said, 'Smith and Sons, I would never have dreamed it. They turned out to be great respecters of the land. They decided to build their houses elsewhere, on land that isn't suitable for farming, and they want to help the farmers. It's too late to help the other farmers whose farms have already been turned into housing developments and places for shopping, but Smith and Sons have decided to help the farmers they can. They feel, in the long run, that farms are as important as our houses.' for what will the people eat if the farms are turned into houses? People may have a place to live, but nothing to eat. Whispers erupted in the meeting house at these words. Clarence continued, "Then the farmer said that Mr. Smith and his sons are working with an idea of forming a new organization to work with the humans, the farmers, and those who build and construct to make sure there is always land to grow crops on. And in regards to our farm in particular, Mr. Smith wants to bring children out to see it, to see a working farm. He's pledged to do his best to see it always stays a farm." At this, a cheer erupted from the mice, and then Pastor Pumpernickel said, "Imagine the farmer receiving such a call on a Sunday. The good Lord must be involved." One of the mice in the congregation shouted, forgetting they were all in church, "Three cheers for Smith and Sons, for Clarence the Cat and his clever plan, and for our new friends Rat-a-tat-tat, Hootrilla, and all the barn rats. Hip, hip, hooray! Hip, hip, hooray! Hip, hip, hooray!" they all shouted. Even the little mice shouted, "Hip, hip, hooray!" with the grown-up mice. Hootrilla the owl then said, "Three cheers for the field mice who so bravely rode on the back of the rats and intertwined their tails, and for Charlie the field mouse who whispered that most effective and beguiling hypnotic suggestion, Farmer McGregor's farm must stay a farm. Farmer McGregor's farm must stay a farm. Hip, hip, hooray! Hip, hip, hooray! Hooray!" they all shouted. "Well," said the timid voice of Hortense, the little mouse organist, "I have a suggestion, Pastor Pumpernickel. Goodness, I don't mean to interrupt."
"Please, please, Hortense," replied Pastor Pumpernickel. "We'd be pleased to hear your suggestion. I'm sure it will be a good one," he said, in his usual kindly fashion.
"Well," Hortense began shyly, "Reverend Mouse, it occurs to me that we might do well to sing a bit. I thought it would be most appropriate that we sing a song together to celebrate and solidify our newfound unity. You see, Rat-a-tat-tat the barn rat, Hootrilla the barn owl, and Clarence the house cat have never been to church with us. Could we sing a song together? Let's sing a song of thanks. Thanksgiving is coming soon, so let us all turn in our hymnals to number 343.
"A capital idea, Hortense. Number 343 it is," said Pastor Pumpernickel. The field mice, Rat-a-tat-tat, Hootrilla, and Clarence all picked up their hymnals, though the print was a bit small for Hootrilla and Clarence. The organ swelled, and together they all sang.
Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thanksgiving time is here, and all we love are near. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you. Thanksgiving time is here, and all we love are near. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God.
And so it was that what began as frightening times for all the inhabitants of Farmer McGregor's farm ended in unity
and Thanksgiving. And ever after, each year in autumn, when the adult mice gathered the bits from the farmer's field at harvest time and listened to the corn concert, they thought of the fall that the farm was saved. And after their day's work was finished and the corn concert was through, they went back to their burrows to tell the little mice of the harvest and sing for them the song of the corn as always. Yet, in addition to telling what had happened during their day of work, and in addition to singing the wonderful song of the corn, the adult mice had a beloved and meaningful story to add to the repertoire of stories that adult mice tell to the little field mice in the evenings before bedtime. And the little mice never tired of hearing it, this story of how the mice, the barn rats, Hootrilla the barn owl, and Clarence the cat all worked together, saved the farm, and gave everyone so much to be thankful for. And of course, no one sang the song of the corn more soothingly or told this story better than Uncle Charlie. For he was, after all, Uncle Charlie the field mouse, storyteller and singer extraordinaire, who had himself whispered the now immortal words into the ears of Mr. Smith and his sons. Farmer McGregor's farm must stay a farm. Farmer McGregor's farm must stay a farm. And all, young and old alike, generation after generation, were so glad that his whisperings had come true. The AbundantChange.com program you have been listening to or viewing was made right here in the Music Outreach Publishing Studio in an effort to reach people of all ages across the United States and throughout the world with delightful, uplifting, instructive materials. In addition to this recording, Music Outreach Publishing offers many other AbundantChange.com books, CDs, cassettes, and videos, which appeal to a wide audience, including children, youths, young adults, adults, couples, and senior citizens. If you would like a recording of this program, or to order any other AbundantChange.com materials, you may contact us any of the following ways. You may call our order line at 317-577-8842, extension 2. You may fax us your questions, comments, or orders at 317-585-0748. You may contact us by email at musicbymichael@aol.com. You may order online at www.abundantchange.com. You may also want to visit our sister websites, music-outreach.com, for uplifting books, recordings, and videos for the elderly, or playsingundream.com for home study courses in piano, voice, guitar, and life enhancement. You may contact author Michael Purvis via the contact page on any of our websites. We wish you peace and many blessings.